talking about the things that matter most to you. Today's Catholic Women. Catholic Women Now with Julie Nelson and Chris Magruder is underwritten by Farm Bureau agent Cindy Schulte, a licensed representative of Blue Cross Blue Shield of Iowa, cindyschulte.com, and Fred Haas, over 30 years helping injured Iowans recover losses from accidents and work-related injuries. Fred Double D, Haas Double A.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Catholic Women Now. I'm Julie Nelson.
And I'm Chris Magruder. Good morning,
everybody. We're so pleased that you're joining us today, and we got a great show today, but we always think we have a great show. We say that every week.
Well, I'm excited because we're going to go a little unplugged and talk about fashion and what we should be wearing and what we shouldn't be wearing at certain
ages.
Yeah,
we're going to give you five ways to know if you're dressing your age or not. So,
yeah, you know, Pope Francis has a little bit to say about some
of that. Well, he talked to a council or a meeting in Rome last week, and he had some interesting things to say about teenagers and parents, and it's good information.
You know,
and it's amazing to me how he knows all this.
I was just going to say, that's what I love about him, is that he's involved in, you know, just the, even the little things, kind of like the Lord.
He's keenly observant, you know. He's got a good sense of what's going on, and very, very wise. So,
yeah, because God is in the practical.
Right. So,
yeah.
So, okay, so it's going to work together here with what the teenager thing and dressing your age here.
And stay tuned because we've got Ann Costa on as well, who's going to tell us a little bit about her book that talks about the Sacred Heart of Jesus and how she has an essential guide for us that we get to follow.
Yeah, I'm excited about that because tomorrow is the feast day of the Sacred Heart of Jesus. So, and June is dedicated to the Sacred Heart of Jesus. And I think a lot of people kind of think of that as being an old, dusty, old kind of devotion and image, but
or they don't even know what it is.
Or they don't know what it is.
Yeah, these generations don't. And you know, I was saying to John Leonetti on the morning show today that, you know, it is kind of an antique devotion. And you know, I want to ask her, is it one and done? Because I've done it. You know, I've gone through the nine first Fridays of each month, and I'm like, okay, I'm good. But I'm guessing I'm probably
And I just like the whole idea of the heart. You know, it's that personal intimacy with Jesus and the heart. And I think, it's more than just information. It's about coming closer to Him and abiding in Him, and He abiding in us.
Right. So, listeners, you got to stay tuned with us because what's old is new again.
That's right. That's right.
Should we start with prayer?
Let's do. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Well, it is good to have you back in the seat again. I kind of feel like you were gone for a long time, but I know, you know, this is the second week you're back. But
I know. Last week, I don't know if I was here because we got in so late the night before. So I was here physically, but I don't know. I think mentally, I kind of was still kind of grasping
and
here.
And you're probably a little tired because you were out late last night preparing for the well.
Preparing for the well. The speakers, we all went through our talks last night, and it's going to be great. It's going to be great. I'm just amazed at the faith of women and people that I know kind of just on the streets, like, hi, how are you? But then to get to know them more personally and their faith life, it's just so incredibly inspiring.
You know, and doesn't it make you love people more when you get to know the heart of Christ in them?
Yes, it does. I mean, you see Christ in them, and it's beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what evangelization's all about.
And it connects you.
Yes, and we women are connectors by nature, which I talk about this weekend.
Oh, very good.
Our sensitivity.
I was going to say the Holy Spirit just tapped into that for me.
Well, thank you, Holy Spirit, for throwing that, pitching that ball to me through Chris.
Oh, very good. Well, we need to say thank you, Cindy Schulte of Farm Bureau Financial Services. She was on our show last week. It was fun to have her in here. She underwrites Catholic Women Now. She's an authorized independent agent. Cindy and her team provide health insurance options from Wellmark Blue Cross Blue Shield. And she does make insurance simple for you. And she's just one of those warm-hearted people that we love to have with us. Cindy's on the web, cindyschulte.com, 515-226-2111.
That's right. Well, I think we're excited here to have Ann Costas join us. She is a Catholic author and speaker. She has five books she's published. Very accomplished author here. Several, including Embracing Edith Stein, Wisdom from Women, from St. Teresa, Benedicta of the Cross. She works with two apostolates, the Sacred Heart Apostolate, and as communications officer and then the John Paul II Center for Women. She's a wife and mother, enjoys traveling, painting, and Eucharistic adoration.
I love that last one.
Yes. Welcome, Anne.
Hi. Well, it's good to be with you today.
Well, thank you for joining us this morning.
Tell us a little bit about yourself and how you were inspired to learn about the practice of the devotion to Sacred Heart.
Well, I didn't know, just like you were saying, I thought it was an old and outdated devotion, and I really didn't understand how it would impact my life today. And I was blessed to run into a woman who spent the last 47 years promoting the Sacred Heart. She lives right in my hometown of Syracuse, New York. Her name is Gloria Anson, and she's been helping families enthrone their homes to the Sacred Heart for 47 years. And I learned about it, and I thought, oh, my gosh, I want what she's got, which was just a tremendous love for the Lord and a deep peace and abiding relationship with Jesus. And that's how I got involved. And then I went to a conference, a writer's conference, and my editor said, well, what are you doing these days? And I said, well, I'm learning about the Sacred Heart. And she said, oh, I'd love for you to write a book. So I was a beginner writing this book, The Essential Guide to the Sacred Heart. But, oh, my goodness, once we start to learn about the Lord and His heart, it just opens up a whole new level of love and understanding of how much He loves us. So,
well,
happy.
And your book is Healing Promises. So that piqued my interest, the Healing Promises of the Sacred Heart. So tell us a little bit how the promises of this devotion and how to apply it in our lives today.
Sure. Well, the Lord revealed His heart and in apparitions to St. Margaret Mary Alocoque. She was a visitation nun back in the 1600s. But His desire for us to know His heart is the same today as it was back then. And He said that if you honor my heart, if you love my heart, then I will, you'll never be lost. And these are the 12 promises that have been kind of promulgated through the centuries. They're not the only promises that He's given us, but they're really applicable for today. We see that help is on its way, and through an enthronement, especially because He says, I'll give graces for every state in life. I'll give peace to families, and we'll unite families that are divided. And of course, we know what the pressures are against families these days, and that's a perfect promise for our times. And He said He'll console us in our troubles, and He'll give us refuge during life and death. And you had mentioned those 9 consecutive First Fridays where He said that if you'll go to communion and mass and pray for the Pope's intentions that for 9 consecutive months that you have a grace of final penitence, which means that you'll die not in disgrace, but you'll be able to receive the sacraments. And that's sort of an ongoing commitment that we make to our Lord to be present to His heart so that He can minister to us. And that's really the gist of the promises.
So, Anne, if I have done that, I did that with a friend several years ago, is that something then that I have those promises now for life, or is that something I need to kind of reboot once in a while and go back and do those 9 consecutive Fridays?
You know, it's not a legalistic kind of thing. It really is meant to spark sort of a lifetime connection with His heart. So I would say go ahead and keep trying, keep going. It's a beautiful practice. It's one way to get a respite and just make a little sacrifice in our day to do that, just to bring Him to mind. Like you said, June is another way that we sort of say this is the month of His Sacred Heart. And there are many other ways, though, to practice the devotion. The book is really chock full of different ways in which we can pray or exercise and bring this devotion alive in our lives.
Okay, I have another question real quick, and Julie doesn't know that I'm going to ask this, but I'm very literal. So I'm thinking for our literal listeners out there, you know, the devotion to the Sacred Heart, why do you suppose it's not the devotion to Jesus? You know, because I'm thinking His heart, His physical heart. You know what I mean? Why are we devoted to His heart and not to just Jesus the person?
It's more of like, well, it isn't. I mean, it's entering into the relationship. It's entering into that heart-to-heart relationship with Him. But we're not really devoted. We're not really, devoted to His heart as in, like, say, the devotion to the sacred blood, you know, like there's
sure.
precious blood, right? There's all these ways in which we can encounter Jesus. And I think, you know, or the divine mercy, for instance. You know, some people are more drawn to the attribute of mercy that flows from His heart.
Mm-hmm.
But in essence, you know, and then there's the Eucharistic devotion, and his heart is Eucharistic. So that's what's so beautiful about our Catholic faith, is that we can encounter on so many different levels how Jesus loves us, really. He's just trying to show us, the Father is just trying to show us how much he loves us through Jesus. So to know that he had a human heart, to know that his heart was wounded, he gave us that image, and it's an image, but it's not, it reflects the person that he is, and that's the Father's love through him.
This is Catholic Women Hour, speaking with Ann Costa. She's written a book called Healing Promises, The Essential Guide to the Sacred Heart. And I always think about, whenever I think of the Sacred Heart, I think of John the Apostle laying his head on the chest of Jesus. And when when we're in adoration, there's that sense of nestling in, or at Mass, at the consecration, nestling in to Christ in that moment of great love and nurturing and imbuement of renewing our spirits. I just love that.
I agree. I love that image, and I talk about that in the book, because that's a very beautiful example for us to follow. And I have to tell you, one of the great Sacred Heart saints was Saint Gertrude the Great back in the day. And she actually had a vision of Saint John, and she asked him about that moment when he rested his head on the Divine Heart. And she wondered why he hadn't wrote about that, why we don't know more about that encounter, because we call it, that was the beginning of divine wisdom, when he laid his head on his heart. But it's just a very basic human loving gesture. And she wondered why we don't know more about it. And he told her that that was, that he did learn about deeper, learned about the heart of Jesus in a very profound way, and that that encounter and that knowledge that he learned through that is reserved for the last days and the last times, and that it's specifically there's more to know about the Sacred Heart of Jesus that will be revealed to priests, and that the priests will be the ones that will deliver that great salvation at the end for all of us, so that we can all rest our heads on his heart in heaven.
Wow. I love that image.
Well, it just brings it more prominence to the fact how important it is we promulgate this devotion in today's world. It's now.
Well, and you can just feel love when I'm hearing you talk about that, and when I'm thinking of that image of the apostle putting his head on Jesus, just hearing the heart pound, and just, you know, that it reminds me of when I was little and I would lay on my own dad's chest, you know, or I'd sit in his lap, and you'd feel that love that comes. And that's really what we're talking about, is his love.
That's right. That's right. It is.
Well, you mentioned also in the book something that's kind of interesting, and I don't think a lot of people are aware of it, and that's the enthronement of the Sacred Heart. Can you talk a little bit more about that, why that's important?
And I'll tell you what, our morning show host was saying, hey, when you talk to her, make sure you ask her about, you know, doing it in the home. And I said, well, we're also going to talk about how you enthrone in a business. So we need to hear both sides of that, Anne.
Right. Well, you can enthrone any place, because Jesus said, I will bless those places wherein the image of my heart shall be exposed and honored. And basically, there was a priest by the name of Father Mateo, and he became the apostle of the enthronement of the Sacred Heart. And when you go to your grandfather's place, or your grandmother's home, or you see those images of Jesus with his heart exposed, that Sacred Heart image. And typically what probably happened was they did enthrone their home to the Sacred Heart. You can enthrone a business, you can enthrone a classroom, you can enthrone a radio studio, a nursing home room. We have a home for unwed mothers, and every room has been enthroned to the Sacred Heart of Jesus, where an image is displayed. But really what it is it's a beautiful, very simple ceremony that you prepare for about 3 days before, and it involves your family members. And you can do it even if you're a single person. Usually you invite family and friends there. If family can't be there, you have images. Again, you bring their pictures. The head of the family processes the image and places it in a prominent place in your home. And that symbolizes, that recognizes that you have, that Jesus reigns in your home, that he's your Lord, your friend, and your Savior in your home. And really, it's about having a tabernacle in your home, a place where Jesus' real presence is there. Many families pray before the image. Many families bring their petitions to the image. They're not worshiping the image. What they are doing is they're bringing Jesus in a very real way into their homes, so that they can, like when Jesus, Zacchaeus said, you know, I must go to your home today. Jesus longs to be in our midst, no matter what condition our houses are in, no matter, we don't have to clean up for him. We don't have to do housework. Our family members don't have to be perfect. But what it is, it's a very tangible kind of public way that we commit our homes and our families to the Lord.
Oh, I love that. I love that.
I'm feeling peace and love as you explain this whole enthronement process, too. It's like, yeah, I want this for my family. I want this for my home.
Absolutely.
Business.
Yeah. And when you say the head of the household, and if it's a single person, it's he or she is the head of that apartment or that household, correct?
Yes. And you can either have a priest accompany you on that. You can have them be a part of it, but there's lay people in the enthronement movement who can help facilitate that, or you can simply, you know, go through. There's an enthronement in the book. There's the ceremony is in the book, and there are many resources in the book where you can learn more and prepare and have that in your home. And then the last part of the book really shares the personal stories of families who have done that, individuals who have had incredible encounters with the Lord Jesus Christ through their devotion and the enthronement. So that shares some really neat stories of people shared their hearts with me about how Jesus really did show up in their homes and what happened when he did.
Oh, my goodness. That sounds great. Everybody got to get this book and read this book. No. Well, before we let you go, though, Anne, there's one more thing that we wanted to kind of talk to you about is how our sufferings and trials can bring good when we offer it to reparation to the Sacred Heart of Jesus.
Yeah. When we think about Jesus showed his heart to Margaret Mary, it was hurting. His heart was hurting because at the time, Jansenism was a big part of heresy going on, and that was that people felt they were too evil to approach God at all, and that was literally breaking Jesus' heart.
Well, and I'm sure that's still going on today in many people's minds.
Absolutely. They're afraid to approach him. They're afraid to trust his love. Mm. And he's still lamenting the loss of souls. You know, he's lamenting that. And the way that we sort of console his heart and we want to offer little sacrifices, that's very Catholic, right? I'm going to offer it up.
Right,
it really
right.
is. We can show our love to Jesus in a way that's really tangible. You know, it's very, we're in physical bodies. We're offering little sacrifices for him just to console him like we would anybody who was hurting or feeling rejected or lonely. And that's how I think about it. You know, every sin, and we don't like to talk about sin, but every sin that is committed is hurting his heart. So if we can make up for that in some small way by being just a little extra loving or making a little sacrifice, that's a beautiful way to live. It gives us purpose in our lives, right? It means that everything that goes on, we can offer to Jesus. Every trial has a way to be made into good, and he will do that because he promises to do that in our lives.
Yeah, those sufferings and those trials can become prayers. I know yesterday I was working on something, and I was eating some little chunks of granola, and I felt kind of a little prompting of, don't eat one more, give it up for me. And I was like, really? That simple, that little thing? Mm-hmm. But, you know, they can be big trials, but they can also be little moments,
little
too.
Small sacrifices. I also think about what Father John Ricardo says when he takes, Jesus can take trash and turn it into gold, and that's kind of this refinement that goes on through the reparation of the Sacred Heart of Jesus. Yeah. It's very beautiful, very beautiful.
It's really essential. It's the essence of our faith that really brings life for us every day.
Well, we have 30 seconds. Tell us one of the great experiences that you've had that makes you go, oh, everybody's got to do this because this happened to me one time.
Oh, my gosh, 30 seconds.
Just one blessing, Anne, just one blessing. Yeah, we know you have many.
I have to tell you, I never really thought, my husband always, always struggled with explosive anger, not towards me, but just in general. He had a really, really hard time with it. We were married for 28 years, almost 27 and 6 months of those years. It was really a trial. It was really difficult, very angry, very explosive. The Sacred Heart of Jesus in our home, I noticed he he's not doing that anymore. There was a point in time where we...
I just got chills. Yeah.
And he's no longer that angry person that he was. I never thought that was possible. It was beyond my wildest dreams.
His heart melted your husband's heart.
He really did.
Mm. Yeah.
Oh. What a blessing.
The salve of grace, of healing grace there in love.
Yes.
The love.
Well, Anne, thank you for being with us. Tell us how people can get a hold of you. Your book?
Sure. I have a website. It's www.ann-costa. That's Ann with an E-costa.com. And also, I do speak, and I can come and talk more about it. We can do a mission for a Sacred Heart mission at your parish or in your group, and you can go to cmgbookingforthat.com.
Okay, great. Is the book out? Has the book been published?
It is
out. Great.
Go to your Catholic store and order it, or be on Amazon or Servant Books.
Okay, great. We got Divine Treasures here in town.
Yep, we'll
check it out there with Lois.
Way.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Anne, again, for joining us this morning. This has been wonderful, and I know a lot of our listeners are going to be touched by what you've shared with your knowledge here today. Thank you.
And what a blessing to be with you. God bless.
Keep up the good work for Christ.
Thank you. You too.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're listening to Chris Magruder and Julie Nelson on Catholic Women Now. We're broadcast live from the Mercy Live Up studio in Iowa on Iowa Catholic Radio, 1150 AM, 94.5 and 88.5 FM. And we stream live on iowacatholicradio.com so you can listen to us anywhere in the world.
And don't forget, we have the Iowa Catholic Radio app that you can download free from your app store and take us anywhere.
Yes, and I love that. I do that.
I listen to that more than I do the radio in my home because I can stream it
on
my data, the internet through my home. So, we want to hear from you. We have a texting option here. You can text us your comments to 515-223-1150, 515-223-1150. We love to hear from you.
Yeah, I'm excited. We got some, the Iowa Catholic Radio Strongman event has been postponed, correct?
Right. We don't have a date yet. There was so much interest, but it just, the date was not working for people, but everybody wants to come, so we're going to reschedule it at a time where we can have a lot of the people can come that want to come and be part of it.
And prayers for you this weekend, Julie, because you'll be speaking at the Well, and I don't think people can get tickets at the door for this.
No, it's,
but that's okay. We're still going to pray for you that all goes well. I'm going to be sitting in the crowd cheering for you.
Well, thank you, and I do appreciate all the prayers. And if you're at the Well, come up and introduce yourself to me. I'd love to meet you.
Oh, yes. Julie loves hugs from our listeners.
I love hugs, yes. As I tell my daughter, just cringes, and I'll say, hugs, not drugs. She goes, oh, Mom, okay. Eyeball roll.
She's going to be a senior in high school now, Mom. You know, that's not cool.
That's right. And speaking of cool and being teenagers.
Not being teenagers, right?
Not being teenagers.
Five ways to tell if you're dressing your age, kind of based on an article on Alicia by Adriana Bello.
Right. And it kind of sparked a conversation between you and I because this past Monday, Pope Francis addressed the Diocesan Pastoral Conference in Rome. And being Pope, he's the Bishop of Rome. So he was speaking in, you know, as part of being the Bishop of Rome. It was held at St. John Lateran, and he was talking about several things. But one of the things that he was talking about is parents acting like they're teenagers and not parenting their children.
And there's more competition, he talked about.
Yeah.
In fact, there's more competition between them rather than being examples to their kids.
And he was talking about it, you know, in the light of educating our kids, and he said that parents today compete with their teenage children instead of educating them, and by attempting to be what he calls eternal teenagers themselves instead of role models.
Right.
And kids need role models. Teenagers need role models right now.
You know, and Julie, when you brought up the idea of, hey, let's talk about, you know, five best ways to dress your age, I thought, is she looking at me in my tie-dye shirt that I have on?
Well, we'll talk later about how you can do that and do it sophisticated way. You know, you can still dress trendy.
Yes. But, you know, once again, Pope Francis is right there in the trenches with us, looking at things practically, and he sees some of these things that are happening.
Well, and I think the other thing he talks about is, he kind of hits on a little bit, is that we're afraid to age. You know, we're afraid to age. And he talks about, you're going to love this, Chris. Today, it seems as if everything has to be masked or concealed, and the appearance and not getting old or makeup and that kind of thing and not embracing your wrinkles
and the hair color.
And he says, I think what a shame it is when people dye their hair. And I'm like, oh, okay. Mic drop.
I know.
I was with you and everything, Pope Francis, but that kind of like, okay.
He's calling us out. Yes. He's not just talking about those people who do plastic surgery or the Botox thing. Yeah. He's talking about hair coloring. And I'm thinking, well, gosh, that could take us right to, cold creams and all the things that came out in the 60s to keep our wrinkles away.
I just can't go there right now. No, I got to have hair color. Sorry.
One step at a time, right?
That's right.
One step at a time.
But I like what he said about his aunt embracing her wrinkles and saying, I've earned these wrinkles. And
yes.
And then I was thinking, too, one of the most beautiful people we know is St. Teresa of Calcutta, and how wrinkly her face was, but how beautiful she was in her...
She's such a good example. And, it's funny because I look at some of the sisters that she formed who look very similarly, and they glow.
They glow.
They glow.
And so I think that's an important lesson there for us.
Mm-hmm. And I always talk about I don't mind the wrinkles around my eyes, maybe. I don't like the wrinkles around my lips because I drool a little bit. Kidding. But the idea, of those two 11s that happen between your eyebrows, I'm always like, oh, but if I could get rid of those, because I always feel like they make me look angry. But I've got to remember, those are my thinking lines.
Well, that's right.
Line,
You've earned them. Yeah, we've earned them. Yes. Well, as I say to my daughter, when I do something that's a bonehead move or something that kind of reflects my age, I'll just say, just get used to it. It's only going to get worse. So I'm just going to get more wrinkles.
You know what? Women especially are unsatisfied, with so many things, whether it be, our hair. The way, if you have straight hair, you want curly hair, and vice versa. If you're tall, you don't want to be so tall. If you want to, if you're short, you want to stretch out a little bit more. That's me. We're just not quite always happy.
And I think
it's a lifelong struggle, especially with clothing.
And I think we're trying to capture that youthfulness all the time.
Yes. And, little girls are trying to capture being older. They're putting on the lipstick and their mom's high heels. That's been going on for decades. Yeah.
Well, one thing she talks about is the baby boomers came along and they had this dominance of a youth attitude.
Yes.
And I think that is really true.
Yeah.
And it's amazing for me how much it has kind of seeped into me.
Mm-hmm.
Even though I'm conscious of it, I still kind of, there's parts of me that's like, oh, I am kind of buying into this a little bit.
Right.
I gotta be careful.
And fashion historians will say it really, those trends of being really super slim and looking, like Twiggy the model, started in the 60s.
Right.
And, if you look back to the 50s, you compare the 50s, everybody was wearing poodle skirts. It didn't matter what your age. So, it was kind of the 60s that started that trend.
I have an interesting antidote to that. I sew and I collect vintage patterns, but it's interesting, the sizing on the patterns from the 50s is so much different than it is now. It's interesting how they've changed the sizing over.
Have they changed to make you feel like you're smaller? That's what I always feel like.
They do.
Yes.
And stores do market that too.
Yes, they do.
But anyway, getting back to dressing your age.
Yeah, key to looking your age. What is the key to looking your age?
Well, and I wanted to just kind of start this out, too, with Carolina Herrera, who's a
Venezuelan.
Thank you, designer, and whose clothes I do like. She says, nothing makes a woman look older than dressing if she were younger.
Right.
That
woman who's in her 60s who's trying to wear those really high stilettos with a leopard print mini skirt, Our knees don't look so pretty when we're older.
But it's the irony that we look younger when we dress our age.
Right.
Rather than dressing younger to look
and
younger.
And, in the article did mention people like Jane Fonda, who does look great, or
Helen Mirren.
Yeah.
They dress trendy, but with sophistication and style.
There's a way to do it.
There
you
is
don't
a
have
way
to have that low sinking, neckline.
Right, plunging necklines.
Right.
So,
again, sagging skin.
So the five ways. Number one is, if you keep buying exclusively in a store for adolescents or 20-year-old girls, if you're wondering about H&M, you don't have to worry about that one because they offer options for all ages. And I do like H&M.
Yeah, I do too.
But Forever 21, might be worth passing over. I'm waiting for finally 22, but okay.
Or finally 40, right?
Speak for yourself, sister.
It's funny because listeners, Julie and I were talking yesterday about this, and we were both saying, well, we've been to Forever 21. We're shopping with our girls.
And, I will go in there and I think, oh, that's really cute. And then I'll go try it on. And two things will happen. One, I can't get it over my hips because it's quite a junior cut. And number two, it's so short. It's like, oh
yes.
My gosh.
And they'll also mention once in a while, well, this is a junior store.
Well, and then when I got back to the dressing room one time, I realized I looked around, I was like, okay, I don't belong here at all. You know, what am I thinking?
It is okay. I think sometimes you can find a skirt or a coat or something, and you know, that's right. Trendy. But again, you know, you have to be discriminatory about, yeah, you know, what you find in those places. And they do have some cute stuff. And of course, I like color, so I tend to like places right. like that. But yeah, so, and the second one of the five things to help determine if you're falling into the trap of not dressing your age would be if you're on the street showing enough skin to be on the beach.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. And, you know, I think it comes down to modesty for all yeah, ages, really, that is honestly. Kind of, yeah. It comes down to modesty.
I was in Medjugorje. The priest there, Father Leon, was talking about this, dressing appropriately for Mass. And he goes, it's too much ham and not enough casing. I'm like, oh, my gosh.
That's
quite an image.
I was just going to say, that is quite an image. You're right.
Yeah. Okay. Number three, if you keep dressing exactly the same way you did 10 years ago, are you still wearing that skirt from freshman year of college at age 35? It's time for a change. And I have found that every new decade of life for me is another fashion dilemma. Like, oh, how do I dress now?
Yes.
You know, so.
Yeah, my knees are the things that I'm now trying to hide. It's
I wish I could fit into a miniskirt that I wore in high school, just to be honest, at my age.
I'll tell you what, I still do have clothes in my closet from high school because of those 80s parties. One outfit that I used to wear.
And you can still wear them?
Well, because they're oversized, Julie, remember?
Oh, the 80s, yes, the grunge look.
So I can still do that one 80s outfit that I kept. So, yeah, definitely.
Oh, acid wash jeans, ugh.
Or the floral jeans, yes. Those were funny, too. Yes. So. Well, and number four of the five things that determine if you're falling into the trap of not dressing for your age, if you have T-shirts with cartoons or funny phrases on them. And Adrienne Bello says, just trust me on this one.
Just trust her on this one.
Just trust me on this one.
I know. That is true. That mm-hmm. is true. I did buy a couple shirts one day at Gap a couple years ago, and I had them on. I'm like, it didn't feel right. It's like, I don't need to be wearing these kind of things with all this.
I have recently bought some things with some funny words on them, but I use them for exercise, so right. I feel okay about that.
Right. Yeah. That's different. Mm-hmm. That's different. Mm-hmm. And number five, if your only reference points for fashions are models 25 years old or younger, and if you are 50 years old or more, I recommend you follow this. She recommends Journey of a Stylist on Instagram. And in general, she gets it right and has a fantastic fashion sense. And I think that is really key, too. I will go to Pinterest to some people I know and look and see what they've pinned for fashion and kind of get some ideas for styling and follow people that do that.
Now, have you been to Journey of a Stylist?
No, I follow a gal in Australia and Inside Out Style. And she's actually a wardrobe stylist. She comes to people's homes and helps them. And she's about my age. And she'll go through and, like, if you want to know what flats are appropriate, with what kind of length of pants. She goes through all that.
Okay. Now, we're not saying you can't wear some medium height stilettos or anything like that. I mean, you can dress very trendy. It's just, you know, what's appropriate for our age. You know, sometimes some of those fashions aren't even good for our health. I mean, I'm thinking, you know, those spider veins that pop out when you wear those really high heels too
I can't wear high heels. My ankles are not strong enough.
Yeah, that starts to happen. But there's plenty of ways to look lovely.
There is.
And not just lovely, but beautiful and trendy. You know, sometimes people don't like trendy. They want to look clean. Classic, but there's some trendy stuff.
Well,
that we
you can do
wear.
Trendy with color. I mean, you can wear a color that's trendy in a classic style.
Right. And you know, when we are dressing a little too young for our age, it shows the parts of our bodies that we really don't want to highlight anyway.
Right. Right. Right.
So often I find that, Julie.
Yes. Well, anyway, so I hope that helps everyone out today. And if you're convicted, well, go pray about it. I guess, you know, we're not here to judge in any way or any way.
That's
but
right.
But it was kind of eye-opening for me going through these things for myself as well.
Well, and I think Julie has actually put me on a path, listeners, that I need to get rid of some of my tie-dye, maybe.
Well, I think you can wear tie-dye. It's just the style of the tie-dye you want to wear. So.
Exactly. And today I've kind of got this tunic on, listeners. That I think it fits my age.
Do you feel
it?
Comfortable wearing it?
Oh, I'm so comfortable wearing it. That's why I love it.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. So thanks for helping me out, Jules.
Oh, well, anytime. I can go. I'll go shopping with you and spend your money anytime.
And you know, listeners, she's also good at putting color on you. So if you ever need help with that, call Julie. Call Julie.
Oh, yeah. All right. Well, we're thankful here at Catholic Women Now for the sponsorship of Learning RX. They watching your child struggle in school can be heartbreaking for parents, and they have the help. They do cognitive processing skills. help me out here, Chris.
Well, they have all sorts of brain training and all sorts of tests that they can offer to your children. And it's not just tutoring. I always like to make sure people understand it is about finding out, why does your child have a hard time learning to read? Maybe there's an auditory disconnect, or maybe there's a memory issue. There's several things that are cognitive related that they actually can help with. And they can also help people that have had problems with their brain after a stroke. So you can find many success stories on their website, learningrx.com, and 515-224-4819.
I tell you, that fashion segment just threw me for a loop.
There you go.
Love and marriage, love and marriage.
All right.
Go
so,
together like a horse and
June is wedding month here at Catholic Women Now, and we're sharing tips for marriage guidance from our listeners. So which one do we have today, Chris?
The one listener said, pray as a couple and as a family, especially the family rosary.
Really good.
And I was just talking to a friend recently, and he and his wife were kind of struggling. And I said, well, do you pray together? Do you know that, 99% of people who pray together always stay together? It's like only 1%.
Well, it's Father Peyton, the family that prays together stays together.
Right.
And he started the Family Rosary Society pray.
But, this person that I was talking to said, no, we don't pray together. And I was like, get started.
Couples don't. A lot of couples will pray individually, but not together, too, I've found.
It's very intimate to do.
Yeah.
It is very intimate.
Start with an Our Father.
Yep.
I mean, just
that's
something
right.
simple, and that's powerful right there.
Mm-hmm.
That's
Absolutely.
Just powerful. So.
Absolutely. Well, thank you to Fred J. Haas Law Offices for being a sponsor of Catholic Women Now. He is a personal injury workers' comp medical malpractice lawyer, and he's got over 30 years of legal experience. Great guy. We love him. We always say he puts a new twist on counselor, because he not only can give you legal counsel, but he's just got a lot of wisdom in him as a strong Catholic man. FredHaas.com, FredHaas.com, 515-256-6301.
All right. Well, that wraps up another show here in the Mercy Live Up studio of Catholic Women Now. Thank you for joining us today. The Iowa Catholic Rosary is next, and shall we close in prayer?
Yes. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good and gracious Lord, we love the way that you come to us practically. We love the way that you bless us and offer things like the devotion of the Sacred Heart and the way that you love us through them. We ask, Lord, that you lead us to how we can come closer to you, whether it be through the Sacred Heart or and enthroning you in our homes or in our office places. We ask, Lord, that you be with us and continue to show us your love in the little ways and the practical ways that Pope Francis leads us to, and in the big ways where we need you. We know you are always there. We ask that you help us to abide in you. In your Holy Son, Jesus' name, we pray. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Now go do impossible things for God.
Talking about the things that matter most to you. Today's Catholic Women. Catholic Women Now with Julie Nelson and Chris Magruder is underwritten by Fred Haas. Over 30 years helping injured Iowans recover losses from accidents and work-related injuries. Fred Double D, Haas Double A. And Farm Bureau agent Cindy Schulte, a licensed representative of Blue Cross Blue Shield of Iowa. CindySchulte.com. Catholic Women Now with Julie Nelson and Chris Magruder. Every Thursday at 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. on the radio voice for Catholic Women Now. 1150 AM, 88.5 FM, and 94.5 FM. And on the Iowa Catholic Radio app. Iowa Catholic Radio.